On the freshman team that year was a Purdue washout who would be guaranteed box office for the future, a big teddy bear of a kid from St. Louis named Paul Chrisman.
You see, Paul graduated from Maplewood High School in St. Louis, and his coach was a Purdue man, and he went to Purdue his first year. Somehow they didn't recognize his talent as a freshman, and they sent him home. And of course, the fact that he hadn't competed there, he had 3 years here. And boy, I tell you, he had a great throwing arm and a great attitude for the game. A little bit cocky, but not just self-assured. He wasn't a smart aleck or anything like that, but a great individual.
Now, Paul was not a great runner, but he was a superb passer and a superb quarterback, because he would run a series of plays to set up one that would go the whole way, and that's the way he operated.
The fall of 39 was a wonderful time to be alive in Columbia. The university was celebrating 100 years of higher education. The Shack and other campus hangouts echoed to the swinging sounds of Artie Shaw and Glenn Miller. Cherry Coke sold for a dime at Gabler's Black and Gold Inn. Students flocked uptown to the Hall Theater to watch America's sweetheart, Judy Garland, sing a hopeful anthem for simpler times. Despite what was happening in the rest of the world, life in Columbia seemed to be in order. It was to be the final moment of pure innocence before the entire world went to war. For Coach John Farreau, 1939 would be his first taste of sweet success.
And I remember the first championship in 39. That was a favorite team of mine. Paul Chrisman was a good leader. And it was the first time we'd been up in the national prominence, and they were just a very close-knit team. Managed to lose only one game. That was to Ohio State in the opening game. We won the rest of them and went to the Orange Bowl.
That year, the Tigers traveled to Yankee Stadium to play NYU. Pitchin' Paul ran for two touchdowns and threw for a third to Ron King, who made an unbelievable catch on his back in the end zone. Fortunately for Chrisman, the game was witnessed by syndicated sports writer Grantland Rice, helping to solidify Paul's case as an All-American. That championship season finally boiled down to one game against the Oklahoma Sooners, played on a dreary, misty, late November day. A back-and-forth defensive struggle came down to one play that will live forever in the memories of those who were there.
Game-winning play was a planned play, which I think is illegal now. We pulled the guards on the Oklahoma team. In other words, they were in a defensive position. We pulled them on through, and which left a big gap, and Charlie Mosier went through the gap and blocked the punt. And he's a little bitty guy. I don't know how he got up high enough to do it, but he blocked the punt. And I remember the punt went straight up in the air, and I was looking up and couldn't see the ball. But there was an Oklahoma player, an Oklahoma back, I don't remember his name, but I remembered saying to myself, "You SOB, you're not going to get it." And I really cut him down.
So 1939 became a season of firsts. It was the first Big Six championship, the first national ranking, number six in the AP, and the first bowl bid. After the Kansas game, the Tigers were invited to play Georgia Tech on New Year's Day. But the season of firsts ended abruptly in the sleight-of-hand deception created by the Ramblin' Wrecks' razzle-dazzle backfield. Georgia Tech soundly defeated the Tigers 21-7 on the strength of their crafty hide-and-seek offense. In 1956, he was elected into the College Football Hall of Fame and returned to Columbia for the ceremony in which his jersey, number 44, was retired.
Paul, of course, was a great passer, and he had the knack of delivering a ball to you that was so easy to catch it would make you look silly if you dropped it.
I don't think anyone would ever forget him that ever met with him or played with him, because Paul had one really fine ability as a quarterback. You're getting a tense position in a ball game, and he'd call time out. He just absolutely called time out. He'd see the expression on your face. You're too tense. Everybody was. And he'd always have a little quip. Like one day in particular, he came into the huddle and he said, "I called time out. I want to tell you something. You got to go down to the uptown to the theater tomorrow. You've got to see that cartoon down there."
After playing tennis one day in March 1970, Paul died unexpectedly of a heart attack, far too young at age 51. After the funeral, Don Farrow summed up the Merry Magician best when he smiled sadly and said, "Paul Chrisman was one of a kind."
One of a kind indeed. The 1939 Nebraska game, which personally I think was greater than the Oklahoma game, was a game in which Chrisman, passing the office of the Columbia Tribune when it was downtown, rapped on the window to me as AP correspondent, came in and whispered over my shoulder, "Hey kid, I'll pass those bums out of the stadium by the half." I laughed, but they didn't laugh because he did. He threw three TD passes in the first half. Missouri won by 2 touchdowns, and he was tackled out of bounds at the feet of the Nebraska coach, Biff Jones. He said, "What do you teach these fellows, Major? Touch football?"